Hello, welcome to PCAP's Prairie's Got the Goods Week. My name is Caitlin Rose, and I am the Stewardship Coordinator with Saskatchewan Prairie Conservation Action Plan, or PCAP. Today, Kelly Williamson from SODCAP will be talking about multi-species results-based conservation. This week, we have had a series of webinars going on about ecological goods and services provided by Native Prairie. Check out the PCAP YouTube channel, www.youtube.com/user/skpcap, for recordings of past presentations. Remember to check out the PCAP Facebook and Twitter for cool resources and facts about ecological goods and services. I would like to take a moment to note that financial support for today's webinar is provided by Environment and Climate Change Canada, Wildlife Habitat Canada, and Saskatchewan Cattlemen's Association. A reminder to all of our listeners out there, if you have any questions during the presentation, please feel free to type into the question section of the webinar dashboard at any time during the presentation. Questions will be answered at the end of the webinar. Now, a bit about our presenter. Kelly Williamson is a forage, seed, and cattle producer from Southwest Saskatchewan. With 20 years of experience as a primary producer, combined with a degree in agriculture, Kelly uses his experience to practice agrology in the province. His consulting focus is on various agri-environmental projects, always looking towards advancing methods of environmentally sound agriculture, today and into the future. He is kept current with agricultural-linked boards, including the Saskatchewan Forage Council, the Saskatchewan Stock Growers Association, the Society of Range Management, Pambrun Conservation and Development, Old Wives Watershed Association, South of the Divide Conservation Action Plan, and the Rural Municipality of Whiska Creek. With that, I'd like to turn it over to you, Kelly.
Thank you, Caitlin. Okay, Caitlin had mentioned, I'm a consultant with the South of the Divide Conservation Action Program here in Southwest Saskatchewan. And today I'd just like to talk about some of the conceptualization around our approach to multi-species results-based habitat conservation agreements. I'm not going to talk about any specific agreement. Due to confidentiality, but I'll talk to the broader concepts. Now, just to give you an idea of the geographical area that we're at here, we're working in the Milk River watershed. Excuse me for one second here. There we go. Okay, we are working in an area that has a federal action plan. We have the South of the Divide action plan. That is in place in this area. With that means that there's critical habitat identified across this landscape. And we're also dealing with a sage growth protection order in this area. So we have some acts and some regulation that is in place on this landscape. So that being said, when we're looking for potential projects to work with land managers on this landscape, we created a kind of a coarser layer index to identify areas that would have the highest environmental benefits for working on those areas. So we use these decision-making tools to guide our engagement with potential landowners. So like if that area had EPO, sage growth EPO designated on it, multiple species critical habitat identified on it, connectivity, other aspects would all play into this index for scoring focal areas on that landscape. So the tool we are using here is a results-based agreement. Now, for those that don't know what a results-based agreement are, there agreements that incentives are rewarded for the production of specific habitat attributes. This type of agreement enables the recognition of ongoing management on that landscape. They differ from other programming, which typically pays for infrastructure or other developments and usually one-time payments. Because they're paying for habitat attributes, these agreements require a robust monitoring component in the agreement. So that being said, the overall approach to these multi-species agreements uses the adaptive management approach. Now, this this works well with the results-based agreement because those agreements have the ability to be adaptive themselves, and the data collected with those results-based agreements is able to feed back into that adaptive management process. So the first step is a big GIS exercise. I mean, we've did the coarser layer, looked at indexing the watershed, looked at areas to focus for the greatest environmental benefits. And then once we've identified that and we're engaging, have a landowner that we'll be engaging, then we're going to do another GIS exercise to do finer scale information gathering for that project. We'll be looking at topography, soils, veg cover, eco sites, and different critical habitats that would be identified on those areas, plus the overlaps and the species richness of those critical habitats on those areas. So once that GIS exercise has occurred, then we need to go out and ground truth that area. Some of the GIS layers are not always what they say they are, so need to ground truth them and ensure that that's exactly what's on the landscape. So coinciding with that is the habitat targets. So these targets have been developed through engagement and a process involving the species specialists with these attributes. The targets are applicable to the landscape in which they're being used, so we don't apply targets that are not applicable to the ecosites in which we're dealing with. So this has been developed in the last, we started working on sage growth attributes probably 5 years ago. Pipits probably first started working on about 3 years ago, and chestnut colored longspur, we just started working on them in the last 12 months maybe. But that front end work had already been in the works. So the idea behind these three species in which we identified the targets for is that they're relative to varying degrees of grazing disturbance. And conceptually, we're hoping that spatially we could create an optimal heterogeneity with these species that would encompass many other species. So if we're having species that are the long spurs up here, and then we got pipits down here, we encompass a whole suite of species within this type of agreement. Okay, so once you've decided and worked and identified your habitat targets, now you got to properly apply them on the landscape, and we've created some preliminary indexes, decision-making tools to help lead in this process, taking into consideration once again attributes like EPO, sensitivities, veg cover. We have a target within that chestnut colored longspur target that we would like to shift along throughout that landscape to create that kind of shifting mosaic approach. And since it's a higher degree of utilization, there's be a sensitivity that you wouldn't want to be applying a higher degree of utilization, maybe in in veg covers with increased amount of sage cover. I mean, that would be counterintuitive to promoting sage growth habitat and the recovery of sage. If we set that back, would be detrimental. So when we're applying those targets, and we're shifting that chestnut collar longspur habitat target through that landscape, we want to keep that in mind. The other idea around moving that target through that landscape, allowing some of these areas to transition up. So that's the approach we're using, we have right now. Spatially, we're probably going to have to get a handle on what's existing there naturally, and how much chestnut colored longspur habitat we need to attain on any particular landscape, given what's existing there naturally, and use of the species. That's part of the model. It's adaptive management, and as we learn more, well, that plays back into the system. Now, back to the landowner engagement. We do on our side, we're looking at applying the correct targets on the landscape. On the other side, you're engaging the landowner and you're addressing some potential risks on that habitat. This stuff is right out of the South of the Divide Action Plan. It's their threat assessment table. We're working with the producers going through that. And then now you're going to be going back to that land manager and talking to him about those targets that you've applied on that landscape. And typically the management of most operations is more like a patchwork of a quilt, and we're talking eco sites and management targets that maybe more look like a tie-dye shirt. So you're going to be trying to come up with different strategies with that land manager to try and achieve those outcomes. And it is a little outside of the typical management, but I mean, there are the tools there to achieve it. And here's a typical list of distribution manipulation, and these are some of the mechanisms that you'll be trying to use to manipulate and achieve those habitat outcomes on that landscape. So after the management has occurred. Now, I mean, these are long-term agreements, so these aren't one-off. So we are, it's ongoing management. So it's not necessarily after the management occurs. It's, we'll be measuring for the attributes. Mostly the sage growth attributes we measured early summer, June, into the first part of July, and then the grassland songbird stuff we'll be trying to actually measure now in May, June. It might give us the opportunity while we're measuring for the vegetative targets that we can maybe measure also for species presence and species abundance while we're out there. It's not a part of the agreement, but it might provide us the opportunity to collect more data and verify the veg data that we're taking. So after the monitoring has occurred and it's verified that the targets have met, then the producer receives the incentive that was agreed upon. So that monitoring plays back into the whole adaptive management strategy. The monitoring plays back into the knowledge of the producer. He knows some of the strategies that he's employed, whether they're effective. He understands where he may or may not need to make changes. This information also plays back into the conceptualization and the plans of the project managers themselves. They're able to take that information and maybe review the model itself. That information may be used to adjust targets, protocols, indexes. The species use spatially of habitat targets may need to shift. We may need to look at different monitoring protocols, maybe such as polygon methods, to better capture the heterogeneity goals of the landscape. So there are a few other things that are playing back into our adaptive management model. We have an economic review process ongoing trying to quantify management costs and lost opportunity costs incurred to the producer trying to reach these habitat outcomes. And then it's important to understand those costs and the relationship to public and private benefit. Usually private and public benefit analysis is used to influence policy making decisions, and ultimately policy to making decisions have real effects on the landscape. So we're trying to gain a complete picture of the model, the real costs, and trying to let policy decision makers understand the effectiveness of our model. There are a few other things ongoing. We have PCAP. They're working on new targets for other species. So there's other attributes for plovers, piping plovers, leopard frogs, shrikes, burrowing owls that PCAP has a series of workshops and bringing in species specialists to identify specific attributes and I guess the hope is for multi-species agreements down the road that these can play a role in guidance to those agreements. The other thing that's becoming really prevalent, and I guess it's fairly prevalent this whole week, is the recognition of ecosystem services. And this is just one ecosystem service, but I'm sure several multiple services are supplied with this type of approach. And it would be important for the conservation effort of this of all organizations to maximize environmental benefits across projects on the landscape, and not just to maximize them, but be also recognized for the benefits that they're producing. So with that, I'll recognize my funders, and I will I'll take some questions.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you very much for the great presentation. To all of our listeners out there, please feel free to type in any questions you have into the webinar the question section of the webinar dashboard. One of our listeners was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about how long SODCAP has been around and your future or long-term goals for SODCAP.
I believe SODCAP was incorporated 3 or 4 years ago. We've been working on the landscape for sure for the last 3 years. I'm engaging. Just maybe repeat the last part of that question, Caitlin.
What are your long-term goals for SODCAP?
Long-term goals. Well, I believe the organization is kind of guided by the South of the Divide Action Plan and the goals of that action plan. And the goals of that action plan are to have species delisted. So so the long-term goals is carrying out some of those initiatives and actions within that plan and hopefully being successful.
Great, thank you. The next question from one of our listeners is, what sort of response have you had from producers, and how do you initially connect with landowners?
The initial response from producers?
Yes.
Well, so the initial response to the results-based agreement has been very good. We are just starting to nuance this multi-species approach. My first take on it is we'll have buy-in just like we've had with the other results-based agreements. Lots of producers like the model. They like the flexibility. Achieving outcomes is up to them to use the tools that they have in the toolbox to achieve it. It's non-prescriptive. And it also, I would say, it recognizes them appropriately for being a steward. And it gives them a bit of resiliency as a producer. Was there a second part to that question that I missed?
I think you answered it. Yeah. It doesn't look like we have any questions at the moment, so I'd just like to let our listeners out there know that when you leave this webinar, you will receive an email after this presentation with a quick questionnaire. And if you don't mind filling it out, it will just take a minute, and this allows us to keep our funding to keep these webinars going on in the future. I'd also like to encourage all of our listeners to check out the PCAP website, www.pcap-skf.org. And you can click on the communications tab, and we have a Native Prairie speaker series, which has webinars going on once a month at least. And it doesn't look like we have any more questions, Kelly. So with that, I'd like to thank you again for the really informative presentation. And I'd like to thank all of our listeners for tuning in today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day, everyone.